Hello, hello. Time for chapter 21 of the Ichabod. Professor Freudisham. Professor Freudisham. We'll call him Freudisham. The morning after the funeral, Spittleworth knocked on the door of the king's apartments again and entered, carrying a lot of scrolls, which he let fall onto the table where the king sat. Spittleworth, said Fred, who was still waving his medal for outstanding bravery against the deadly Ichabod and had dressed in a scarlet suit to better show it off, these cakes aren't as good as usual. Oh, I'm sorry to hear that, your majesty, said Spittleworth. I thought it right for the widow Beamish to take a few days off work. These are the work of the under pastry chef. Well, they're chewy, said Fred, dropping half his fancy cake back in his plate. And what are all these scrolls? These, sires, are suggestions for improving the kingdom's defences against the Ichabod, said Spittleworth. Excellent, excellent, said King Fred, moving the cakes and the teapot aside to make more room as Spittleworth pulled up a chair. The very first thing to be done, your majesty, was to find out as much as we could about the Ichabod itself, the better to discover how to defeat it. Well, yes, but how, Spittleworth? The monster is a mystery. Everyone's thought it was a fantasy all these years. That, forgive me, is where your majesty is wrong, said Spittleworth. By dint of ceaseless searching, I've managed to find the foremost Ichabod expert in all of Cornucopia. Lord Flapoon is waiting with him in the hall. With your majesty's permission, bring him in, do, said Fred excitedly. So Spittleworth left the room and returned shortly afterwards with Lord Flapoon, and a little old man with snowy white hair and glasses so thick that his eyes had vanished almost into nothingness. This, sire, is Professor Freudisham, said Flapoon, as the mole-like little man made a deep bow to the king. What he doesn't know about the Ichabogs isn't worth knowing. How is it that I've never heard of you before, Professor Freudisham? Asked the king, who was thinking that if he'd known the Ichabod was real enough to have its own expert, he'd never have gone looking for it in the first place. I live a retired life, your majesty, said Professor Freudisham, with a second bow. So few people believe in the Ichabod that I've formed the habit of keeping my knowledge to myself. King Fred was satisfied with this answer, which was a relief to Spittleworth, because Professor Freudisham was no more real than Private Nobby Buttons, or indeed old widow Buttons in her ginger wig, who'd howled at Nobby's funeral. The truth was that beneath the wigs and the glasses, Professor Freudisham and widow Buttons were the same person, Lord Spittleworth's butler, who was called Otto Scramble, and looked after Lord Spittleworth's estate while he lived at the palace. Like his master, Scramble would do anything for gold, and had agreed to impersonate both the widow and the professor for 100 pieces of gold. So, what can you tell us about the Ichabod, Professor Freudisham asked the king? Well, let's see, said the pretend professor, who'd been told by Spittleworth what he should say. It's as tall as two horses, if not taller, interrupted Fred, whose nightmares had featured a gigantic Ichabod ever since he'd returned from the marshlands. If, as your majesty says, not taller, agreed Freudisham, I should estimate that a medium-sized Ichabod would be as tall as two horses, whereas a large specimen might reach the size of, let's see, two elephants, suggested the king. Two elephants, agreed Professor Freudisham. And with eyes like lamps or glowing balls of fire, suggested the king. The very image I was about to employ, sire, said Freudisham. And can the monster really speak in a human tongue? Asked Fred, in whose nightmares the monster whispered, The king, I want the king. Where are you, little king? As it crept through the dark streets towards the palace. Yes, indeed, said Freudisham with another low bow. We believe the Ichabod learnt to speak human by taking people prisoner. Before disemboweling and eating his victims, we believe it forces them to give it English lessons. Suffering saints, what savagery, whispered Fred, who'd turned quite pale. Moreover, said Freudisham, the Ichabod has a long and vengeful memory. If outwitted by a victim, as you outwitted it, sire, by escaping its deadly clutches, it has sometimes sneaked out of the marsh under cover of darkness and claimed its victims while he or she slept. Whiter than the snowy icing on his half-eaten fancy cake, Fred croaked, What's to be done? I'm doomed. Nonsense, your majesty, said Spittleworth bracingly. I've devised a whole raft of measures for your protection. So saying, Spittleworth took hold of one of the scrolls he'd brought with him and unrolled it. There, covering most of the table, was a coloured picture of a monster that resembled a dragon. It was huge and ugly, with thick black scales and gleaming white eyes, a tail that ended in a poisonous spike, a fanged mouth large enough to swallow a man, and long, razor-sharp claws. There are several problems to overcome when defending against an Ichabod, said Professor Freudesham, now taking out a short stick and pointing in turn to the fangs, the claws, and the poisonous tail. But the most difficult challenge is that killing an Ichabod causes two new Ichabods to emerge from the corpse of the first. Surely not, said Fred faintly. Oh, yes, Your Majesty, said Freudesham. I've made a lifelong study of the monster, and I can assure you that my findings are quite correct. Your Majesty might remember that many of the old tales of the Ichabod made mention of this curious fact, interjected Spittleworth, who really needed the King to believe in this particular trait of the Ichabod, because most of his plan relied on it. But it seems so unlikely, said Fred weakly. It does seem unlikely on the face of it, doesn't it, sire? Said Spittleworth with another bow. In truth, it's one of those extraordinary, unbelievable ideas that only the very cleverest people can understand, whereas common folk, stupid folk, sire, giggle and laugh at the notion. Fred looked from Spittleworth to Flippoon to Professor Freudesham. All three men seemed to be waiting for him to prove how clever he was, and naturally he didn't want to seem stupid, so he said, Well, yes, well, if the professor says it, that's good enough for me. But if the monster turns into two monsters every time it dies, how do we kill it? Well, in the first phase of our plan, we don't, said Spittleworth. We don't, said Fred, crestfallen. Spittleworth now unrolled a second scroll which showed a map of Cornucopia. The northernmost tip had a drawing of a gigantic Ichabod on it. All around the edge of the wide marsh stood 100 little stick figures holding swords. Fred looked closely to see whether any of them was wearing a crown, and was relieved to see that none were. As you can see, Your Majesty, our first proposal is a special Ichabod Defence Brigade. These men will patrol the edge of the marshlands to ensure that the Ichabod can't leave the marsh. We estimate the cost of such a brigade, including uniforms, weapons, horses, wages, training, board, lodging, sick pay, danger money, birthday presents, and medals to be around 10,000 gold coins. 10,000 gold coins, repeated Ten Fred. repeated King Fred. That's a lot of gold. However, when it comes to protecting me, I mean to say when it comes to protecting Cornucopia, 10,000 pieces of gold a month is a small price to pay, finished Spittleworth. 10,000 a month, yelped Fred. Yes, sire, said Spittleworth. If we're to truly defend the kingdom, the expense will be considerable. However, if Your Majesty feels we could manage with fewer weapons... No, I didn't say that. Naturally, we don't expect Your Majesty to bear the expense alone, continued Spittleworth. You don't? Said Fred, suddenly hopeful. Oh no, sire, that would be grossly unfair. After all, the entire country will benefit from the Ichabod Defence Brigade. I suggest we impose an Ichabod tax. We'll ask every household in Cornucopia to pay one gold coin a month. Of course, this will mean the recruitment and training of many new tax collectors, but if we raise the amount to two gold coins a month, we'll cover the cost of them too. Admiral Spittleworth, admirable. Spittleworth said, King Fred, what a brain you have. Why, two gold coins a month. People will barely notice the loss. I think the people are going to have something to say about that. So here is a picture that Charlotte, aged 8, wow, wait to see this picture, from the Republic of Ireland has drawn. And it was to go with the sentence, there, covering most of the table, was a picture of a monster with thick black scales and long razor-sharp claws. Look, she's only 8 and she drew that. Okay, right, we'll find out tomorrow what the people have to say about the gold coins a month. Okay, bye-bye.